Hello and welcome to Argumenta Podcast. So today with us, we have Ms. Sandhya Ravishankar. Am is actually an investigative journalist who's currently based in Chennai. And I think most of you must be already knowing about several of the most famous case, what happened, especially with regard to the illegal beach sand mining in Tamil Nadu. And also as a journalist, the kind of challenges what she has faced, the threats and the harassment as well, and also how she had to battle it out in court as well, especially the case which was fought against the miners as such. Ma'am is the has won the prestigious Ramnath Goenka Award. And I think many of you must be knowing that it's one of the most prominent awards in India, especially for journalism. And since ma'am has basically covered around the miners issue and also several other environmental topics in hand, and since she has an abundant love for environmental journalism, and especially if those are kind of the investigative kind. So ma'am, welcome to Argumenta Podcast, and I hope you're doing well, ma'am.
Thank you very much. I'm doing well, and it's nice to be here. Thank you for having me.
Yes. So ma'am, like if you can just start from the very beginning, like what really made you choose journalism as a career? And also while choosing your career, did you actually analyze any kind of the possible threats or any kind of attacks or what might happen as well to journalists as well? So the kind of abuse and threats what journalists face regularly as such. So did you analyze that while coming into the journalism field? And also if you could share your insights about how it has been so long as such.
Okay, so I think my first memories of wanting to be a journalist go back to possibly 8th standard in school, because at that time I was very sure that journalism meant that I would be able to travel to different cities and different countries and all over the world, and I'd never, you know, put my feet down in one particular city and live there. But so travel was a big lure. So that's when I decided to be a journalist. But of course, it's got nothing to do with travel. But it's changed over the years. When, you know, we start off with a lot of idealistic notions about wanting to change the country and society and, you know, wanting to make a big name for ourselves. And of course, at that time, when we were very young journalists, that was the time when journalists like Barkhadat and Rajdeep Sardesai were, you know, they were stars then. And we all looked up to them and we said, okay, we want to grow up to be like Barkha and be a war correspondent. So, you know, that was the next goal. Didn't really get very close to a war. But then as you grow, as you learn, as you gain experience in reporting, in you know, finding out information, you find that there's a little war being waged everywhere. You don't have to face the rockets and the, you know, the rocket launchers and the machine guns to actually be in a war. There are lots of little wars being waged everywhere. And I think today, if you ask me what I think journalism is to me, I would have to say that it's a quest for justice. And I think it's very similar to what all of you lawyers are also studying to do. It's a quest for justice. So there's not much of a difference between you and I. But yes, the whole, I think the entire profession has changed. The way journalists are looked at has changed. There was a lot of respect for journalists at one point of time. Today, that is not the case. That's due to a lot of reasons, but it's a lot tougher to be a journalist, and especially an investigative journalist nowadays, because there are so many hurdles to cross. And you're always at cross purposes with authorities, you're at cross purposes with your own fraternity, and it takes a toll on someone who wants to bring the truth out, because the truth is hidden by so many layers, and it's that much more difficult to get it out now. That's how I feel.
Ma'am, if I may ask, the legal battle that was something that you had literally undergone for almost such a long period of time. I mean, a lot of people literally refrain from getting into legal hurdles, because we are well versed with this fact, because while we intern, being law students, while we go for internships and all, we find that there's a situation where people actually fear to go beyond their limits or to step into a legal, you know, hurdles to be crossed per se. But considering that the case ma'am has actually undergone through, or the lesson ma'am has literally put forth to the society, so literally fight for the quest of justice is a very, you know, something that of a great deal. So ma'am, at any point of time during this legal, you know, little legal battle, have you ever found it like literally so difficult to move forth, or the kind of energy that is required to, you know, there might be times of disheartening situations. You know, we know law, you know, to learn law itself is a huge trouble that we people undergo. So you might have definitely faced at some point, like you would have felt to like give up. So what was the kind of energy that you had to come forward, or what was the motive that literally led you to this legal struggle, ma'am?
Well, there were actually two defamation cases that were filed by the minor against me. One of them involved my husband as well, and for no reason whatsoever. But the good thing, I think what really worked out well was that the first two respondents were the Economic Times, where the article was published. So that saved me a lot in terms of legal costs. So the Economic Times took this fight forward legally, and I'm really glad they didn't give up, because it would have been so much easier for them to just say, you know what, this is just too much trouble. Let's just put an apology, print an apology and say, you know, sorry, we didn't mean to offend you. Our story is entirely wrong, blah, blah, and just let it go. It would have saved them a whole lot of money in legal costs. But it was brilliant that the Economic Times decided to fight this battle. And it was, I think it went on for what, 5 years before it was, you know, resolved in such a manner. And honestly, as far as the defamation cases were concerned, I gave up at the beginning, because the only thing we were worried about was that, you know, we wanted to be done with, we wanted to do away with the personal appearance. And that was, we were lucky enough that the Madurai bench granted it in the beginning itself, so that, you know, otherwise the process is the punishment, right? The lawsuits like this, they force you to come all over the place. Like I live in Chennai, I'd have to travel to Madurai. There was a summons in a Tirunelveli Sessions Court, so I would have had to travel all the way to Tirunelveli. It's not, I mean, the process is the punishment. That's how they try to wear you down. But it was really good that the Madurai bench first, did away with personal appearance. So I didn't have to go to court. In fact, I never appeared for this in person for this case even once. So that was a relief. And I mean, defamation cases, see, we've in Tamil Nadu, we've lived through the times of Jayalalitha, and every term of Jayalalitha's is full of defamation cases against journalists. So it's we know that it's just it's an intimidation tactic. It's just to try and keep the journalists in line, and it makes no difference to anybody. It just goes on forever. It lies in the court forever, and every now and then, you know, when the government changes, the cases are dismissed. So that's how it generally happened. But this case, I was really surprised, because I honestly was not even following it. It has just been too long. And I was not even in touch with the lawyer who was fighting this, though I had given him all the material beforehand. And then one fine day, one of my friends, who's a senior journalist in The Hindu, he called and he said, congratulations. So I was like, what do you mean? Congratulations for what? So he says, don't you know, you've got such a brilliant judgment. I said, judgment in what? So he said, your defamation case. I was like, oh, wow, that actually got over. So, you know, it's just a defamation case is just like, okay, it's a case. Fine, you know, it will go on till I die. So that's generally the attitude most of us have towards defamation cases. But the very fact that it was a rigorous judgment. I think Justice G.R. Swaminathan had taken the trouble to go into each and every nitty-gritty claim made by the petitioner, and he pretty much, he did a slam dunk entirely. So that was a very pleasant surprise.
And because what I found interesting was that towards the end, I think what was found that like the claim that you wrote the article on behalf of your husband, I think the judge made it very clear that if we accept the contention of the complainant's counsel, then that would undermine the agency of the woman concerned as such. So that was especially a very key point which you brought about, that even with the current times, people's mindset have changed a bit, but then they're able to accept the profession as such. Mohammed, also my question, like since we opened this this event, many of them like, oh, she's one of the most unbiased news journalists as such, because mostly what the norm is that okay, this particular journalist belongs to one camp or the other camp. So considering not just Tamil Nadu as well, but also the journalistic field as such, how do you analyze the ideological balance as such? So is it wrong to have an ideological backing and do the kind of reporting what one can do, or else can one claim to be neutral as such? Like example, what one might say in the US is that they try to they openly endorse the particular presidential nominee as such. So can that be a particular model wherein instead of trying to be claiming yourself as neutral or as unbiased as you are, that in there itself comes the hypocrisy, is what some might point out as well. What are your points with regard to that?
To be fair, I don't think anybody can be entirely 100% neutral or unbiased, because we're all human, and you know, whatever we do, our biases and our predilections do creep into our work. What we are trained to do is to guard against it. Okay, so that's part of what journalists are trained to do. They are taught that, you know, you question your own biases. You when you're coming to a conclusion on a particular story, you question your own conclusion. You talk to two people, three people, and, you know, see what they're saying, whether they come to the same conclusion as you. So this is generally how we are taught to ensure that we don't have confirmation bias or any other, you know, biases that creep into our work. And of course, we have a very robust, at least print has it, a very robust system of a whole, you know, hierarchy of sub-editors and then the editor-in-chief. All of these people are very experienced senior journalists who vet each copy down the line, right? And that really helps, because if somebody senior to you manages to catch a bias, then and pulls it out, you know, it's great, right? I'm not very comfortable with the US system of, you know, endorsing one particular party and then going ahead and reporting on it, simply because I don't think we're in the business of endorsing a political party or an ideology. I don't think journalists are in that business or should be in that business either. Yes, I do agree and understand that not everybody can be completely unbiased and neutral, but we need to try. And we really, really need to try hard, especially in these times. And okay, let me give you a small example. So on social media, right, on Twitter, I'm a little more active on Twitter than on any other platform, but it's the same across the board in any social media platform. All of you must also be privy to this. So if you say, for instance, if I say something positive about the Narendra Modi government, I'm automatically a Sanghi. Okay, so I have a whole bunch of people. Most of them are like, they don't look like humans, right? They're either bots or they're people masquerading as something else. Some IT wing chaps. So they land up on my timeline and they say, you're a Sanghi. They call me Sanghiya, stupid stuff like that. And then if I say something, you know, if I criticize the Narendra Modi government, I have these same, you know, whole bunch of people with little Indian flags on their accounts. They land on my timeline and they start abusing me. And if I criticize the MK Stalin government, I have a bunch of these fellows coming and abusing me again, calling me Sanghiya for what joy, nobody knows. But apparently, if you criticize the ruling party in Tamil Nadu, you are automatically a Sanghi. You can't be anything else. And similarly, if you if you criticize the Narendra Modi government, then you are automatically something similar to an anti-national character. Okay, so because it is not in the nationalistic fervor to criticize or critique a government which we have voted to power. So this is the system, and journalists have also divided themselves into these camps. It is very evident, right? So how it also works very sadly is that, you know, they are not looking at holding power to account, which is what a journalist's job is, right? We are supposed to hold power to account. We are supposed to ask for transparency and accountability. But a government which could be, you know, which is maybe in politically in opposition to the BJP, okay? Any government, it could be any political party, but small party. Any government, any political party that is in opposition to the government is always seen as, you know, being right by people who don't support Modi, right? So there's a bunch of journalists who don't support Modi, and they say anybody, any political party that opposes Modi is absolutely right. And then you have a bunch of journalists who support Modi, and for them, everybody else is wrong. And they start attacking journalists who question the others. Right. So I
is that different in a regional and in the national scenario as such? Because maybe what we see in the national scenario is wherein that the Modi and against Modi and so, but more localized or in state wise, is it a bit different as such?
It's not different. Look, when you're looking at the national media, what are they doing? The mainstream national media, they are all speaking in support of the party in power at the center. What are the local regional language media doing? They are speaking in support of the party in power in the state.
Yes.
Where is the difference? At the end of the day, you are supporting a party that is in power. That doesn't make you a journalist. It just makes you a, you know, public relations expert. That's all. So this is a serious problem. And the lines are so blurred that people attack each other, and it becomes really vicious. I mean, you forget at the end of the day that we're all journalists, and you know, we're all struggling to put out stories. There is, you know, our freedom of press, freedom of expression is being, it is under question everywhere in any state that you work under. It's not better just because we are in a DMK ruled state, you know, it just because the DMK is in opposition to Narendra Modi, it doesn't make the DMK ruled state a haven for journalists. No. So I think journalists have to accept and address the fact that we've gone too far away from the profession, and it's time to come back and figure out what we are going to do with ourselves.
So just like ma'am has stated now, the whole, you know, the whole argument that revolves around all these incidents that are happening time and again, is that all those individuals who are patrons of someone will automatically tend to not take criticisms anymore. They're no more willing to take criticisms and, you know, gain the or attain the actual element of correction in themselves, because they're not at all willing to correct anymore. And ma'am, I even had this question. I mean, it is a bit dynamic question. I definitely went to a lot of interviews ma'am had given off, and I was really impressed with the interview that was given to the Quint. And there ma'am had classified the entire judgment. I mean, three major pointers were laid down from the judgment of the Madras High Court, where one was the duty of the court in proactive involvement to enshrine the freedom of speech and expression under Article 19(1)(a) for the journalists explicitly. Secondly, about the institution of criminal defamation itself, which often amounts to the abuse of power to harass the journalist. And thirdly, I also found that mere technical errors cannot constitute criminal defamation. So the whole judgment is not just a matter of fact that can, you know, provide independence or actual freedom to journalists, but the whole article is being molded with an altogether different definition by this judgment. So ma'am, it's almost half a decade. I mean, it had been a half a decade fight for you before the court, and thereby years have passed. But today at this particular point, if we look into the current system or how journalists are able to work, their freelance working, and all those things, if you look into consideration, not just Article 19(1)(a), we have gone beyond, we have entered into Article 21, with the right to privacy being a question mark as well. We don't know if my, I am not aware if my phone call is being tapped by somebody whom I don't even know, whom I have no idea about. So we have all stepped beyond reasonable restrictions, and there are things coming into, I'm not stating it's just the National Party as such, but everywhere, it's the same everywhere. If you get the power, you have the right to abuse. I mean, you get into the right to abuse as well. So ma'am, what do you think is the current scenario of journalism? So the major challenges faced by journalists, I have heard ma'am definitely pointed out many of them, but at this point of time, when you have threat calls coming up and the murder of journalists also happening, UAPA charges coming into picture. So ma'am, what do you think are the current challenges faced by journalists? And there are, you know, brewing journalists coming into picture, blooming journalists, or young minds who want to become journalists also. What is the kind of message that ma'am has to those individuals as well?
Well, journalism right now has become a bit of a war zone, if you want to call it that. It's we're battling against a whole lot of pushes and pulls. And these come not only from state actors, they come from non-state actors as well. And it's unfortunate, but the non-state actors are also backed by the state actors. So it's a situation where it's very difficult for either an individual journalist or a publication, a journalist who's, you know, who's attached to a publication, to actually report on something that's very controversial, or some, or even conduct their own investigation and go forth. What is the challenge? The main challenge is that I think, and it all boils down to this, the biggest challenge is that newspapers, online portals, as well as television channels, their sources of funds are largely government. Ads. So they're dependent on the government for ads. And it becomes very, very difficult otherwise, because people don't want to pay. I mean, a newspaper would probably cost 25 rupees to buy, but you know, we're paying only 3 rupees for it. The rest of it is heavily subsidized by government ads, which are printed in the papers, and also other you know, corporate ads. But the government ads form the lion's share of revenues for print. So in a situation like this, there's not much one can do, because the government basically has you by the throat. It can be any government, it can be the central government, it can be the state governments, whichever government. As long as they're giving you ads, they've got one hand around your throat. And that is a big deterrent to any kind of investigative journalism that comes out. But those who do venture into that, I think right now we're a bunch of us are trying to form a support system of some sort. And it's an international support system that they were trying to form with the help of you know, organizations like the Committee to Protect Journalists and Reporters Sans Frontiers. So this is basically a coming together of a bunch of organizations internationally who give voice and provide support to journalists who are taking on risky assignments in the public interest. So that's one good thing that has come out. And especially in the last few years, where attacks on journalists, cases, like you said, UAPA cases, sedition cases, all these have been filed just to harass, it's become a very, very difficult situation. But at the end of the day, I think journalists also have to realize that we don't really have the support of anybody. And even if we're part of a mainstream publication, a big publication, it's not likely that they won't, that, I don't think they will stand with you beyond a point, right? Because if the water gets too hot, they're going to throw you out. So we have to realize that we're on our own, largely, but there are a lot of support systems in place. And it's up to us to make use of those support systems, because there's a lot of stuff available. Like if you're facing a UAPA case or a sedition case, there are funds earmarked for that, so that, you know, you can meet the legal expenses of fighting these cases. And these are provided by organizations like CPJ, RSF. This is stuff that is very important, because, you know, when these cases were hitting me, I didn't know who to turn to, right? Because I wasn't sure whether the Economic Times would fight on my behalf, or I had to engage my own lawyer, because I was a freelancer and I didn't have the money to engage a lawyer. Most of us don't have the money to engage a lawyer. So it's really up to us to make use of these resources. And also, I think going forward, we probably need to conduct workshops for young journalists who have an interest in investigative journalism on how to safeguard yourself. Because at the end of the day, nobody is going to protect you. You're going to have to take care of yourself. And there are ways to do it. We have to be smart, but there are ways to do it. And I think that training needs to come.
Nowadays, we'll have to attach a self-defense system also with the degree, because things are not going to go on away, because we'll have to run for our life nowadays. But hopefully, things will have to work on the right way, because if the whole point of democracy is the involvement of media as the fourth pillar. And if we lack this, I don't think there's a point of referring it to as democracy at all. So Joel, you had a question.
Yeah. Also to the audience here, if you have any questions, do put forward in the comment, or if you would like to speak up as well, you can raise your hand accordingly. If also accordingly, I'm going to address. Since you spoke about your stint with the ET, and you were a freelance journalist, if I'm not wrong. Ma'am, what is the responsibility of the editor in with regard to how they process your article? So how do they really cut across the number of, because they also might be analyzing, okay, the kind of notices you might get with regard to your piece as such. So were you in a situation wherein you had to defend for your story, and also how to pursue against the editor who might want you to actually put an apology or tone down a bit as such? Or also, ma'am, with regard to sources as well, especially in your field, how are they being protected as such? Especially, they have an imminent risk to their lives as such. So how are their lives in place? Or are they dependent on you? Or do they charge you as well in some instances as such?
Okay, I'll answer your first question first, which is you had asked me... Sorry, it just flew out of my head.
I asked you about the responsibility of the editor or those who
proofread your article. Right. Okay, so I think in the country there's one breed of editors or managers, if you want to call it that. And this rare breed is just absolutely phenomenal. Okay, it's a small group of people, but I was lucky enough that one of them was the editor of Economic Times on Sunday, because the Sunday edition was a separate edition altogether, and only they took freelance copies. The regular Economic Times on other days that did not take freelance copies. So it was only Sunday. It was a magazine, right? And it had a brilliant editor called Brian, and I was really, really lucky to have Brian. And my immediate superior was... one Binoy Prabhakar. He's now with CNBC TV18. But both of them were so brilliant. They were absolutely steadfast. And they said, you know what, even though she's a freelancer, we're not going to throw her to the wolves. And we're going to fight. So they convinced their management, which was obviously heaping pressure on them, saying, you know, why do we have a defamation case over a freelancer's article? You know, why should we bother? Just put an apology and finish it off. Close it. But... Brian was brilliant, Binoy was brilliant, and both of them stood up and said, no, we're definitely going to see this through to the end. So it really depends on the editor you have. And I'm happy that, you know, there are still quite a number of them. They're in different parts of the country, in different organizations, but they're there, and thank God for them. Your second question was on...
protection of the sources, and also have you been... at a particular instance wherein they have charged you for your scoop as such, have they really asked you money as such with regard to your piece?
Okay, we never pay any money to any of our sources. That's like a basic rule. I have never paid one paisa to anybody. But most sources, especially in the beach sand mining story, they have risked their lives and their occupation. Right, lives and livelihood they have risked to tell me the truth and to pass on documents and to pass on information about what is happening in that particular sector. So it's that's a phenomenal experience, and I'm still in touch with all of them. Of course, we try and keep all the communication as much under the radar as possible, and we don't make regular phone calls and stuff like that. Because I mean, Pegasus, yes, but can't fight Pegasus. But you can definitely fight the regular phone tapping that governments generally indulge in. So that's.
I saw your tweet regarding that as well, with regard to your how with regard to like governments will always know more than often in a very illegal manner. So keep changing phones.
I got rather trolled for that, because I mean. People were saying that I'm an apologist for the government, but it's the truth, you know. Today is Pegasus, tomorrow it will be some, you know, Zeus or Thanos or something. Something is going to come and it's going to infect your phone, and governments are going to read what you're saying. They want to know your conversations. It doesn't matter what government is in power at the center. You know, if the opposition comes to power next time, they're going to do the same thing. All we can do is, we have to fight against it. We have to raise our voices against it. And it's great that the Pegasus story has come out. I worked on it initially as well. But at the end of the day, we have to be smart. I can't say, you know, it is unethical for the government to snoop on me and I will continue to use my phone as I am. Really, I'm endangering so many lives.
And ma'am, there have been like comments being made by people who have who influence a lot of people that India is going to be, I mean, India has been a kingdom and the king has all these rights in the middle of or in the midst of all these problems coming up. I mean, let's listen to that as well, because there are people who are easily influenced by these kind of comments. So I always think that when you make these kind of statements, make sure there are people to follow you. I mean, nobody understands that. Okay, I'll keep that aside. That's an irony part of this whole story. And ma'am, I had like one last question to you, because I'll definitely value this opinion of yours as well, because the two things that always come to mind when it comes to the freedom of journalists specifically with respect to their with respect to their reporting and all, one was section 499. Obviously we had a discussion about this and the case and everything on site. Secondly, UAPA, yes, of course. So these two statutes as such had been in use ever since the colonial era, like all of us do. And these two have come into picture recently with regard to a lot of debates, because the UAPA has been used back then by the Britishers to crush down the nationalist freedom movements. So ma'am, what is your opinion upon this fact that do we still need this statute to crush down the criticisms or any sort of opinions coming against the government per se? Or do you think it is the matter of fact, okay, it is fine to have this at hand? Or do you think it is something to be immediately scrapped per se?
Okay, I have a slightly different opinion on this from a lot of my compatriots. I have spoken to a bunch of lawyers, policymakers, and they have explained the need for a law like the UAPA, a draconian law like the UAPA. But it's there to fight people who are waging war against the nation. The problem is that these laws are being misused. Abused, right? Yes. How do we stop the abuse and the misuse? That is the question we need to be addressing. We need to look at why lower courts are just, you know, allowing this to happen. And, sending people to jail without even applying their minds. These are questions we need to ask. It's not a question of whether you're repealing a particular law or something. The law is there for a purpose. It serves a particular purpose and you need it for the nation's security. You do need it. You can't say that you don't need it. But the problem is with the abuse or misuse of that law. It is being used against activists. It's being used against people who question the government. And that is wrong. That needs to be fought, and some checks and balances need to be brought in so that it is not abused. And we need to question, there's a whole hierarchy, there's an entire system, right from, you know, how you file a charge sheet to how you remand a person. There are so many steps, there are so many checks and balances. The system is broken, it is not working properly, and that is the problem. We need to fix the system. I don't think there's an issue in terms of needing to fix the law, but the system definitely needs to be fixed.
Yes.
All right. Ma'am, I take the risk of sounding naive and a little irrelevant, but I'll still nevertheless ask this question. Right now, we see a huge wave of ignorance and mediocrity in social media, especially where news and current events are concerned. How do we come to conclusions? Because not everyone takes the necessary steps that a good journalist does, but everyone has an opinion and they shout it louder than everyone else. So how do we find our way around all of this?
Well, frankly, I think social media is a great place to stay connected. But if you're looking for news, I would recommend that you identify news outlets that are largely independent, largely unbiased, and stick with them. I mean, you can have 2-3 different sources of news, of course, and it's more likely that you're going to get a reasonable picture of the reality than if you're looking through social media. So I wouldn't, I mean, social media is great for conversations, but that's about it.
Not for news. Yes, any other questions everyone had to pose? Or is, yeah, ma'am, actually, since right now you're currently with India Head, if I'm not wrong, right? And thought like it was actually an English channel, and usually English channels are based out of Delhi, Noida, but then this is actually in South India, if I'm not wrong.
Well, yeah, so India Head is owned by the Andhra Prabha Group, and Bhupendra Chobe is the editor in chief.
CNN.
So, yeah, so it is headquartered in Noida. Oh. All of the PCR and the equipment and the, you know, the production team, all of them are there. But they are more south focused, which is why, you know, we've started this show called Vanakkam Tamil Nadu on weekdays, 8 to 8:30 a.m. It goes live in the morning, and it's purely on Tamil Nadu. So they also have an afternoon band which is south focused. So I think between 1 and 3 in the evening, there's a lot of news about from all of the South Indian states. So there is a distinct effort to cover the South more and more intelligently and not be, you know, too North centric.
Yeah, Delhi centric. Right now, I think your division is currently an online listening, or comes on the on television as well, on cable as well, or it's completely online?
So right now, I do this one show on the television channel, the English channel. And then we're just in the process of kickstarting a Tamil digital platform. It's called India Ahead Tamil. And that's going to be a pure digital platform.
Ma'am, so how, like, since the latest information technology, the intermediaries, the basically about the media ethics as well. So having gone through it as well, there are several conditions with regard to putting forward a grievance officer, grievance mechanisms, oversight mechanism also, especially as an online entity. How will the new rules change the entire aspect of the online content? Because as of now, unlike the print or the one on TV, you basically have a few guidelines as well. But right now, since till now, there was not much of a guidelines or restrictions on the online online news platform as such. So how does that really change the entire procedure as well? Because everyone right now can be a journalist online.
Everyone is a journalist, or they think they are at least. But the rules that you're talking about, they don't apply to online news media. They're applicable to platforms like Twitter and Facebook, which host other people's opinions. So these rules apply to them, which is why the government and Twitter are locked in a battle right now. But online news platforms, they do require some amount of I think there is a registration or a vague kind of licensing that is required. It's not a very difficult process. It's just that you have to write to the government and apply, and you have to make sure that, you know, you inform them that you're in the business of news, online news. So this is the beginning of I'm sure this is going to be used at some point to strangle freedom of press online, but that's okay. I mean, we still, there are a lot of issues also, and in terms of, you know, fake news and deliberately twisted news that is being put out online, which needs to be curbed, and I guess this is one way to do it. But otherwise, we really don't have any restrictions.
No restrictions. especially with regard to how the how are election reportings taking place, especially in the South. So how was the entire procedure? Because we just concluded the elections on May 2nd, if I'm not wrong. And how was the what are the kind of norms that you take when you're interviewing the candidates as well?
Election coverage is generally chaotic, and television tends to follow the star campaigners or star candidates, and basically it's just one big festival, which is great for television because it works really well on television, right? But there are a lot of newspapers as well as digital portals. They have actually traveled a lot, done a lot of ground reporting, spoken to people on the ground, and attempted to highlight issues that are specific to the region or to the community, and try to make sense of how the elections, what the main issues are in the elections. So there's a good mix. I think that's the takeaway, that there is a good mix of the glamour and the noise and the fireworks of elections. Yeah, and also a good amount of thoughtful reporting that has gone into it.
Ma'am, to as we reach towards the end of the session, I had this question, like many of the people will definitely have this in mind, since ma'am has said that Twitter is the social media platform that ma'am is more actively into. I mean, when we post something, if somebody is not, okay with what we have stated, irrespective of factual check or whatever from their side, there might be some messages coming, or from fake accounts with no identity, with some images or so-called symbols ma'am had stated before. How do you react to these messages? There are people who, completely ignore all of these, but there are situations where we get triggered like anything by seeing certain messages, which do not have identity also. So ma'am, how do you, or what kind of a take do you have towards these kind of individuals and their actions?
Well, honestly, I'm still trying to master that. I'm not very good at it. I tend to react. I tend to try and explain myself. So I make the mistake of giving a very normal, sane explanation for what I have tweeted. I try to explain and justify my tweet, which has annoyed a lot of people. And then I realized that it's really, why did I try? And then after that, I just...
They won't understand.
No, they don't want to listen. They just want to say something and then it's shoot and scoot, right? So they just want to abuse and then leave. So it's...
That's all. Exactly. We even end into fan fights and all. I'll just give an example of fan fights. Like there are actors over here, we follow somebody and all. Oh my goodness, our whole day's mood will be, all gone if you fight with these people. Because the kind of comments they make, we can't even reply. The kind of words they use, we don't have any idea about. I have to ask my parents, what does this mean? In our language, I don't understand what kind of abuse they're calling me. Yeah. So there are situations like this. I mean, we either have the option to ignore or to convince them. Convincing is almost impossible when they're toxic, like anything. Okay, so Joel.
Yeah, you have so many other, you have very vested interest groups also, who come there just to attack you and then, defame you. There's no point reasoning with any of these people. So I'm still learning. I have not mastered it. I tend to react. So I have to learn not to do it.
Okay.
Yes, ma'am. So I think before, I just have this one pertinent question, because I think you have also written a book on Karuna Nidhi as well.
How does
a journalist writing about a particular person who has a very significant importance of the state compared to a usual biographer as such? So example, you do have biographers who write about a particular person, what he did and the kind of roles he has played in the state, his ups and downs. Mostly sometimes there can be a bias of not really putting the downfalls of the person as such. So as a journalist, how did you go into while writing about the iconic person?
Writing about Karunanidhi was, easy and tough at the same time, because easy because he's just touched so many people's lives. So each person I spoke to had a different experience of meeting and dealing with Karunanidhi. But also the fact that he was such a, you know, larger than life figure, it was very difficult to get the underlying truths out. And also he was a prolific writer. So he's written like a 5-part series, his own autobiography. Each book is like this. It's in Tamil. It's called Nenjikin Nidhi. There are 5 parts to it. And that also doesn't, like, in the latter, towards the end of his life, he was not able to write. So it's actually an incomplete autobiography. So, you know, you have someone who does this and who's, he's not black or white, right? He's like 200 shades of gray. Yeah. Where do you start and where do you finish? It was very, very difficult to condense that enormous life into one book. But I think being an official biographer, if I had been an official biographer, I wasn't. It's an unauthorized biography, yeah. Unofficial biography. But if you were an official biographer, you wouldn't have been able to do much except write that person's life the way that person sees it, right? And you're going to get only that perspective.
Yes.
Whereas having written it from a journalistic standpoint, I think it was inevitable that, you know, you bring in all of the corruption charges and the various other issues that plagued this politician and try and do some amount of justice to the life of this, you know, quite a phenomenal person. And, you know, and to show that at least out of the 200 shades of gray, we try to show at least 10 shades. So I think that was by and large the only attempt.
Yes, so I think as you come to the end, ma'am, if you could just share your insight as to what really inspires you to do what you do each day, like you come to the office and you do, despite so many events which have happened to you as such, and how you would like to inspire upcoming journalists as well in the field.
Well, as I told you in the beginning, I think journalism today, to me, it means looking for justice. And it could be justice in any form, in any shape, in any color. And I think all of my efforts and in the future, now and in the future, would be to seek justice. That's basically it.
Oh, so that is a very, you know, that answer has a lot of inner elements in it, because quest for justice can define all our questions at hand. And Ma'am is one of the biggest role models we have right before us to fight whatever the case be in quest of justice. And that's a great, great model for us. So very gratefully, we would like to conclude this session, because I know from this paucity of time, from ma'am's extremely busy schedule, she's here for us on a Friday afternoon. Okay, so thank you so much, ma'am, for your valuable time, because this has been really much insightful for each and every individual who has joined and for each and every individual who's going to see this in a few days. So considering the fact that we don't have any more questions coming up from the audience, we'll wind this up. So thank you so much, ma'am, once again, on behalf of Team Argumenter Podcast. We missed one of our members. I mean, he was a little bit engaged.
It was his birthday, so last minute, that call to come over. So that's the reason why.
Yes, he missed this session. Okay, I feel bad for him now. So thank you so much, ma'am, once again.
Thank you so much for having me. It's been really nice talking to all of you, and it's nice to see that someone cares about all these things, especially people your age. So thank you for that, and fight the good fight.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you so much, ma'am, for coming forward and being very patient with my texts with regard to the session as such. I'm really sorry.
Thank you.
It's a big honor for us.
No, not at all. It's my pleasure. Thank you
for having me. Yes, ma'am. So you can watch the session on the full session on YouTube and on Instagram as well, and also on our platform as well. So do stay tuned to it, and also do follow Argumenter Podcast. Also, ma'am, if you're currently working on any project as such in the upcoming days as such, or what you'd like to really, if you could just suggest a few readings as well to the audience before we leave.
Well, right now I'm in television, so I'm not doing much reading. Right. I'm going to have to make some time for that. But unfortunately, the digital Tamil digital platform is taking up all of my time right now. But yeah, I mean, I'm hoping to set that in motion and then get back to doing some serious reading. I have a lot of books at home which I really want to read.
Okay, that's it.
Thank you so much. Thank you everyone for joining us as well.
Thank you. Thanks.
Hello and welcome to Argumentive Podcast. And as you all know, we are a podcast here to discuss, deliberate and debate on several social, legal and political issues. So our episodes are available on YouTube, on Spotify, on IGTV and several other podcast platforms as well. So do like, share and subscribe to our channel on YouTube and also follow our Instagram page with regard to regular updates as well.